In this lecture, I will give you few examples for the use of density matrix. In the last class, we defined density matrix. Also, we derived the theoretical formulations of density matrix. Now, consider the examples. The first example is an electron in a magnetic field. Okay? A single electron, which has an intrinsic spin half h cut sigma and magnetic moment mu p, is placed in an external magnetic field. The intrinsic spin half h cut sigma, where sigma is Pauli spin operator, and the magnetic moment mu p is e h cut divided by 2mc. This spin can have two possible orientations, either up or down with respect to an applied magnetic field B. So consider the magnetic field to be in the Z direction. Then the Hamiltonian takes the form H cap is equal to minus mu B into sigma dot B. This B is in the Z direction, and this Pauli spin operator, it has three components: sigma x, which is 0, 1, 1, 0, sigma y, it is 0, minus I, I, 0, sigma z, it is 1, 0, 0, minus 1. The only Pauli spin matrix which is diagonal is sigma z. That is why we choose the direction of magnetic field along z direction. Therefore, this sigma dot b becomes b sigma z cap. So the Hamiltonian operator is h cap is equal to minus mu b b sigma z cap, or h cap is equal to minus mu b b. When multiplied with this sigma z matrix, you will get it as minus mu b b 0, 0, mu b b. This is the Hamiltonian operator. This is the Hamiltonian operator of the system. A single particle, the particle is electron with a magnetic moment in mu b and spin half I h cut sigma. Now, density matrix, as per the definition from canonical ensemble, density matrix rho cap is e raised to minus beta h cap divided by trace of e raised to minus beta h cap. So first we want to take the exponential of this matrix, that is e raised to minus beta h cap. Since this matrix is diagonal, you can directly take exponential of these diagonal elements. Okay, and this is possible only if the matrix is diagonal. Okay, if a matrix is diagonal, I will show that. Suppose you have a matrix D which is diagonal. D1, 0, 0, D2. Then what is D square? D square is D1, 0, 0, D2 multiplied with D1, 0, 0, D2. So the first element is D1 square. Second element is 0. This element is 0. And the last element is D2 square. Continuing like this, you can show that d cube will be simply d1 cube 0 0 d2 cube, etc. etc. D raised to n will be simply d1 raised to n 0 0 d2 raised to n. Okay. Now, what is exponential of a matrix e raised to d? It is simply I plus I is identity matrix, d divided by 1 factorial, plus d square divided by 2 factorial, plus d cube divided by 3 factorial, plus etc. So e raised to d is, here identity matrix we have to take 2 by 2 identity matrix, because the order of matrix d is 2 by 2. And d is d1 0 0 d2 by 1 factorial, plus d1 square 0 0 d2 square divided by 2 factorial, plus etc. this I can write it as e raised to d is equal to summing all the matrices. The first element is 1 plus d1 by 1 factorial plus d1 square by 2 factorial plus etc. The 1-2th element is 0 for all matrices. So the sum will be 0. 2-1th element is also 0 for all matrices. So sum will be 0. 2-2th element is 1 plus d2 by 1 factorial plus d2 square by 2 factorial plus etc. What is the first element? 1-1th element is nothing but e raised to d1. 1-2th element is 0. 2-1th element is 0. And the 2-2th element is e raised to d2. So if a matrix is diagonal, exponentiation is directly can be directly done by exponentiating the diagonal elements. Okay, that is why e raised to minus beta h cap becomes e raised to, this is minus beta into h cap. H cap, you have a minus mu bb here. So minus beta, when you multiply with the minus beta, this becomes beta mu bb. E raised to beta mu bb, 0, 0, and e raised to minus beta mu bb. Okay, this is possible only if the matrix is diagonal. Now, what is trace of this matrix? Trace of this matrix means the sum of diagonal elements. That is e raised to beta mu bb plus e raised to minus beta mu bb, where mu b is Bohr magnitude, right? Now, the density matrix rho cap is e raised to minus beta h cap divided by trace of e raised to minus beta h cap. So this is density matrix. This is density matrix for a single electron. For a single electron placed in an external magnetic field of strength B. This is the density matrix. Okay. This is how we can calculate the density matrix. Now, expectation value of sigma z. What is expectation value of sigma z? By our definition, expectation value of a quantity is trace of rho cap into the operator corresponding to that quantity. Okay? So here sigma z is the quantity. So expectation value is trace of rho cap sigma z cap. What is rho cap sigma z cap? Rho cap is the matrix e raised to beta mu bb 0 0 e raised to minus beta mu bb divided by e raised to beta mu bb plus e raised to minus beta mu bb into sigma z is 1 0 0 minus 1. The only diagonal poly spin matrix 1 0 0 minus 1. When you multiply this, the first element is e raised to beta mu bb. And 1-2th element will be 0, 2-1th element will be 0, 2-2th element will be minus of e raised to minus beta mu bb. Therefore, trace of this matrix will be e raised to beta mu bb minus e raised to minus beta mu bb divided by e raised to beta mu bb plus e raised to minus beta mu bb. This is nothing but tan h beta mu bb. In lecture number 14, we derived an expression for component of magnetic moment along the field direction as mu z is equal to mu b tan h beta mu b b. Okay. We also know that this magnetic moment mu is equal to g e by 2 mc into spin angular momentum s. And here we have S is equal to half h cut sigma cap. Okay. And for spin motion, the Landage factor G is equal to 2. Therefore, I can write mu as E h cut divided by 2 mc into sigma cap. Therefore, the component of mu along the z direction, mu z will be e h cut divided by 2 mc into sigma z. So this is e h cut by 2 mc is nothing but mu b. Sigma z is the expectation value of sigma z is tan h beta mu bb. So exactly the same result we obtained from lecture number 14. Okay, these two results are identical. So this is the advantage of using density matrix for finding the observable quantities in the case of statistical mechanics. Now we will consider the second example, that is a free particle in a box. Again, it is a single particle in a cubical box of side length L. The Hamiltonian is given by h cap is equal to minus h cut square divided by 2m delta square, because Hamiltonian of the system is, since it is a free particle, it will have only kinetic energy, and that is p square by 2m, and the operator corresponding to p is minus I h cut del. Okay, so that becomes minus h cut square by 2m del square. Del square is actually dou square by dou x square plus dou square by dou y square plus dou square by dou z square. Therefore, I can write the Hamiltonian operator like this. Now, the eigenfunctions phi should satisfy periodic boundary conditions, because it is a cubical box of side length L. So, the wave function should satisfy phi evaluated at x, y, z should be equal to phi evaluated at x plus L, y, z, and that should be equal to phi evaluated at x, y plus L, z. That should be equal to phi evaluated at x, y, z plus L. Okay. Since the particle is inside a cubical box of side length L, the wave function should satisfy this periodic boundary condition. And if we apply that, we can find the wave function phi E of r as 1 divided by L raised to 3 by 2 e raised to I k dot r. E raised to I k dot r. And the energy eigenvalue is given by E equal to h cut square k square divided by 2m. Because energy is purely kinetic energy, p square by 2m. P is h cut k. So that becomes h cut square k square divided by 2m. Now we can write the wave vector in terms of components kx, ky and kz. And this kx is 2 pi by L nx, ky is 2 pi by L ny, and kz is 2 pi by L nz. Why these values? Because this wave function should be periodic. That is, phi of x plus L y z should be equal to phi of x y z. And the wave function has the form e raised to I k dot r, and that becomes e raised to I kx x plus ky y plus kz z. This is phi of x y z. What is phi of x plus L y z? It is e raised to I kx x plus kx L plus ky y plus kz z. For these to be equal, e raised to I kx L should be 1. That is, kx L should be a multiple of 2 pi. That is, kx should be 2 n pi by L. This n, I can denote it as nx. That is why this kx is 2 pi by L nx. So, in order to satisfy the periodic boundary condition, I can write k as 2 pi by L nx ny nz. If I call this nx, ny, nz as components of a vector n, I can write wave vector k is equal to 2 pi by L n. This vector n has components 0, plus or minus 1, plus or minus 2, etc. Because this n should be 0 or plus or minus 1, plus or minus 2, etc. Only integer values. Okay. Now, in the coordinate representation, density matrix will have components rho is equal to bra position vector rho cap at position vector r prime. Okay. So, rho is equal to bra position vector r. Rho cap is e raised to minus beta h cap divided by trace of e raised to minus beta h cap ket r prime. Okay. For evaluating this quantity, we have to first evaluate this quantity, that is bra r e raised to minus beta h cap ket r cap, and that is equal to bra r e raised to minus beta h cap. I can insert an identity operator, which is sum over all eigenfunctions phi e outer product with itself, okay, and get r prime. And this is identity operator, so it will not make any difference. Now, e raised to minus beta h cap acting on phi e, it will give you e raised to minus beta e into phi e. And this summation, I will write it first, sigma e bra r e raised to minus beta e ket phi e bra phi e and ket r prime. Okay, we can take this e raised to minus beta e outside, and this becomes sigma e raised to minus beta e, and this quantity, this is nothing but phi e of r, and this quantity is nothing but phi e star of r prime. Phi e star of r prime, we already know the values of phi e of r and phi e star of r prime. So substituting here, we can calculate it as sigma summation over e. I replaced it with the summation over wave vector, because in wave function also I replaced e raised to minus beta e with it. In place of e, I substituted h cut square k square by 2 1, and since there are two wave functions phi e r and phi e star r prime, this 1 by l raised to 3 by 2 and 1 by l raised to 3 by 2 becomes 1 by l cube, and the remaining thing is e raised to I k dot r into e raised to minus I k dot r prime. So this can be written as 1 by l cube sigma k e raised to minus beta h cut square k square by 2 1 plus I k dot r minus r prime. Now we know that k is equal to 2 pi by l n, that is l by 2 pi k x, you can write it as n x. This is vector equation. For components, you can write l by 2 pi k x equal to n x. If you take the change l by 2 pi delta k x equal to delta n x. For two adjacent points, delta n x is 1, because n is integers. So for two adjacent points, delta n x will be 1. So I can write this as l by 2 pi delta k x equal to 1. Similarly, l by 2 pi delta k y is also 1. L by 2 pi delta k z is also 1. Therefore, multiplying all those, I will get l cube divided by 2 pi cube delta k x delta k y delta k z equal to 1 into 1 into 1, that is 1. Okay, multiply this left hand side, and then you will get l cube divided by 2 pi cube delta kx delta ky delta kz. Multiplying the right hand side, you will get 1. So from this, I can write 1 by l cube. Take this l cube to the right hand side. 1 by l cube is delta kx delta ky delta kz divided by 2 pi whole cube. Okay. So instead of this 1 by l cube, I can write 1 by 2 pi cube, and then there is a summation k. E raised to minus beta h cut square k square by 2 pi m plus I k dot r minus r prime, and this delta k x delta k y delta k z. If variation is very small, that is for very large L, okay, if L is very large, delta k x will be very small, okay, because delta k x is 2 pi by L. If L is very large, this deltas, I can replace it with d. That is delta kx becomes dkx, delta ky becomes dky, and delta kz becomes dkz. And together, you can call this as d cube k. Okay? D cube k. And the summation will get replaced with the integral. Will replaced with the integral. So, I can write bra r e raised to minus beta h cap at r prime is equal to approximately equal to 1 by 2 pi cube integral e raised to minus beta h cut square k square by 2m plus I k dot r minus r prime d cube. This I can split into three integrals, because this is a volume integral, I can split this into three integral. In the first integral, I will write 1 by 2 pi integral e raised to minus beta x square. This k square, I can write it as kx square plus ky square plus kz square. And kx square, I will write in the first integral. Plus I, this k dot r minus r prime, I will get first component as kx x minus x prime. The next one will be ky y minus y prime, and the last one will be kz z minus z prime. So in the first integral, I will write plus I kx x minus x prime, and in d cube k, I will write dk. Similarly, you can write the second integral as 1 by 2 pi integral e raised to minus beta h cut square ky square by 2m plus I ky y minus y prime dky. And the last one is 1 by 2 pi integral e raised to minus beta h cut square kz square by 2m plus ikz z minus z prime dkz. All these three are similar integrals. So I will calculate any one. So consider this first case. E raised to minus beta h cut square kx square by 2m plus ikx into x minus x prime. I can write it as e raised to minus of a perfect square. That is square root of beta h cut square by 2m into kx. If you take the square of this quantity, you will get this first term. And there will be a 2ab term. A minus b the whole square is a square minus 2ab. That minus 2ab term is this one, ikx x minus x prime. But there will be a last term plus b square. And that plus b square due to this I, that will be minus of x minus x prime square divided by 4 into beta h cut square by 2. So I have to subtract that term because that is an additional term. There is only two terms here. When you take a minus b the whole square, the last term b square is additional. So you have to subtract that term. That is why this e raised to minus x prime square divided by 4 into beta h cut square by 2. Call this entire quantity in the square bracket as u. So this becomes e raised to minus u square, e raised to minus m into x minus x prime square by 2 beta h cut square. If the entire quantity inside square bracket is u, then what is du? Du is square root of beta h cut square by 2m into dkx, because this is a constant. Okay, dkx. I changed the integration variable kx to u. Now that integral becomes 1 by 2 pi integral e raised to minus u square e raised to minus m x minus x prime the whole square by 2 beta h cut square into, instead of dkx, I have root 2m by beta h cut square du. We have the familiar identity integral minus infinity to infinity e raised to minus u square du equal to root 2 pi. This integral, each of this integral runs from minus infinity to infinity, that is all the possible values of kx. Therefore, I can replace this integral e raised to minus u square du from minus infinity to infinity as root 2 pi. The remaining terms are constant. Root 2m by beta h cut square is here. E raised to minus m x minus x prime the whole square divided by 2 beta h cut square. Rearranging this, I'll get square root m divided by 2 pi beta h cut square e raised to minus m x minus x prime whole square by 2 beta h cut square. In a similar manner, the second integral will give you square root m by 2 pi beta h cut square e raised to minus m into y minus y prime whole square by 2 beta h cut square. And the last integral will give you square root m by 2 pi beta h cut square e raised to minus m z minus z prime whole square by 2 beta h cut square. Multiplying all those, the constant terms all are same, square root m by 2 pi beta h cut square, multiplying 3 times you will get it as m divided by 2 pi beta h cut square whole raised to 3 by 2. And these quantities, when you multiply this, you will get it as e raised to minus m divided by 2 beta h cut square into x minus x prime square plus y minus y prime square plus z minus z prime square. And that is nothing but mod r minus r prime whole square. So this is the value of this quantity. Now, if you take trace of e raised to minus beta h cap, you simply put r is equal to r prime. Okay, and integrate over all possible values of r. Okay, you for taking the trace of a matrix, first you have to equate the indices m equal to n and then sum over all values of n. In a similar manner, in the position representation, in order to find the trace, first you have to put r equal to r prime, then you will get diagonal element, okay, equivalent to diagonal element, then sum over all values of r. Okay, instead of summation here, since r is a continuous variable, you have integral. So integral bra r e raised to minus beta h cap at r d cube bar will give you trace of this e raised to minus beta h cap. And if you put r equal to r prime, this becomes e raised to 0, it is 1. M divided by 2 pi beta h cut square all raised to 3 by 2 is constant, it will come outside. Integral d cube bar is the total volume of the cubical box and it is V. It is V. So this is trace of e raised to minus beta h cap. And this expression is exactly the same one that we obtained for partition function q1 beta of a single particle inside a box. Okay. In the case of canonical ensemble, we calculated the partition function for a single gas molecule inside a box, and exactly the same relation we obtained there. Okay. Now, our aim is to find the density matrix, and it is given by bra r e raised to minus beta h cap divided by trace of e raised to minus beta h cap at r prime. We already obtained an expression for bra r e raised to minus beta h cap at r prime, and that is given by this expression. This divided by trace of this matrix, that is m divided by 2 pi beta h cut square raised to 3 by 2 into v. This factor m divided by 2 pi beta h cut square raised to 3 by 2 will cancel, and you will get this as 1 by v into e raised to minus m mod r minus r prime square divided by 2 beta h cut square. Okay, this is the expression for density matrix, and you can see that the off diagonal element rho r r prime is symmetric between the states r and r prime. If you interchange r and r prime, there will not be any difference for this element. So rho r r prime is symmetric between the states. So in the while studying density matrix, we mentioned this property: density matrix is always symmetric about its arguments. Now, coming to diagonal element, for finding the diagonal element of density matrix, you put r equal to r prime, then this becomes 1 by v. So the diagonal element is independent of r. Diagonal element is constant and it is given by 1 by v. And it is the probability density for particle to be in the neighborhood of a point r, and it is independent of r. For the particle, all positions are equally likely. For the particle, all positions are equally likely, and the probability of finding at a particular point is given by 1 by v. Now, the off-diagonal element bra r rho cap ket r prime, that is equal to 1 by v e raised to minus m mod r minus r prime square divided by 2 beta h cut square. It is a measure of probability of spontaneous transition between r and r prime, between two positions r and r prime. So it is a measure of relative intensity of the wave packet associated with the particle at a distance mod r minus r prime from the center of the packet. So the spatial extent of the wave packet, and that is of course a measure of uncertainty involved in locating the position of particle, and it is of the order of h cut divided by mkt raised to half. What is the meaning of spatial extent of wave packet? For explaining that, you consider a one-dimensional case a Gaussian function. F of x is equal to e raised to minus mod x minus x naught square divided by 2 sigma square. In this figure, I took x naught as 2, and this is the plot of e raised to minus x minus 2 whole square divided by 2 sigma square for different values of sigma. As sigma increases, this exponential decay will decrease because this is in the denominator. Okay, so this is for large sigma. This is for small sigma. Sigma is known as standard deviation, and it is a measure of the spread of this wave packet around the center. Okay, it is a measure of spread of the wave packet around the center. Small sigma means the spread is very small. Comparing with this equation, in our case, it is 1 by v e raised to minus mod r minus r prime square divided by 2 beta h cut square divided by a. So comparing these two, I can say that instead of sigma, we have this quantity h cut divided by root mkt. So it is a measure of the spatial extent of the wave packet from the center of wave packet. Okay. Now, the spatial spread is actually a purely quantum mechanical effect. In classical physics, there is no spatial spread. The particle should be at a particular point at a particular instant. Okay, there is no uncertainty in the position of the particle. It should be at some point. Okay, but in quantum mechanics, that position is not certain. So there is a spatial spread of the wave packet. Now, what happens in the limit t tends to infinity? In the limit t tends to infinity, this sigma will be very small, and as sigma decreases, you can see that this wave packet tends to a delta function. This wave packet tends to a delta function. That is a sharply peaked function at a particular point. There is no spatial spread. So, in the limit t tends to infinity, the quantum mechanical results will converge to the classical result. Okay. So, the wave packet becomes delta function and the particle will confine to a point. Now, we can calculate the expectation value of Hamiltonian itself, and that is given by, as per the equation from the density matrix formulation, the expectation value of a quantity is trace of that quantity, the operator corresponding to that quantity into the density operator. Okay, so trace of h cap rho cap. Substitute for h cap, minus h cut square by 2m del square, and substitute for rho cap, it is 1 by v e raised to minus m 2 beta h cut square mod r minus r prime square. Trace means you put r is equal to r prime and sum over all possible values of r. That is the meaning of taking trace. So, you calculate this del square of this quantity, that is del square of e raised to minus m. Mod r minus r prime square is nothing but x minus x prime square plus y minus y prime square plus z minus z prime square divided by 2 beta h cap square evaluated at r equal to r prime d cube. Del square, it will have three components, dou square by dou x square, dou square by dou y square, and dou square by dou z square. First, I will calculate dou square by dou x square of this quantity plus dou square by dou y square of that quantity plus dou square by dou z square of that quantity. Into d cube r is dx dy dz, and all this should be calculated at r equal to r prime. That means x equal to x prime, y equal to y prime, z equal to z prime. Now, minus h cut square divided by 2mv is in the outside. Then integral dou by dou x. This is a dou square by dou x square. So, first I will take one derivative. Then I will obtain e raised to minus m x minus x prime square plus y minus y prime square plus z minus z prime square divided by 2 beta h cut square multiplied with minus m divided by beta h squared square. Multiplied with minus m divided by beta h squared square. There is one more time. X minus x prime square derivative with respect to x is 2 times x minus x prime. That 2 is cancelled with this 2. So, you will get it as minus m x minus x prime divided by beta h squared square. So, one derivative is over. Now, one more derivative. Dou by dou x. You have to take one more derivative. So, you should have to use the product rule. You take this as first function and this as second function. You can, of course, take this constants outside. Minus m divided by beta h squared square. This minus sign and this minus sign becomes positive. So, outside you have h squared square by 2mv into m divided by beta h squared square integral. You keep this as constant and take the derivative of this thing. What is derivative of x minus x prime with respect to x? This 1. Then you keep x minus x prime as constant. What is derivative of this quantity? That is e raised to minus m into that quantity inside square bracket divided by 2 beta h squared square into 2 x minus m divided by 2 beta h squared square into 2 x minus x prime. Okay, that 2 will cancel. That 2 will cancel. There will not be any 2 here. And it is minus m into x minus x prime divided by beta h squared square. And all these have to be evaluated at x minus x prime, y equal to y prime, x equal to x prime, y equal to y prime, z equal to z prime. There is of course a derivative with respect to y and z. Okay, so there is of course derivative with respect to y and z. But it is trivial. Okay, you just do one derivative. In a similar manner, you can do the derivative with respect to y and z also. Finally, you have to substitute x equal to x prime. Then y equal to y prime and z equal to z prime. Then this becomes e raised to 0 and that is 1. And this quantity becomes 0. This quantity will vanish. So that will give you 1. And similarly, from dou square by dou y square also you will get a 1. From dou square by dou z square also you will get a 1. So total you will have 3. Integral dx dy dz will give you v and that v will cancel with this. So, you will get it as 3 by 2 beta and it is nothing but 3 by 2 kt. So, the expectation value of Hamiltonian is 3 by 2 kt. This is nothing but the internal energy of the system. So, expectation value of Hamiltonian should be internal energy of the system. So, this is the procedure. Trace of h cap, rho cap and this is the mathematics. Now, I can calculate expectation value of h using this expression also. Trace of h cap e raised to minus beta h cap divided by trace e raised to minus beta h cap. Because rho cap is e raised to minus beta h cap divided by trace of e raised to minus beta h cap. This I can write it as minus dou by dou beta of log trace e raised to minus beta h cap. Okay. So, minus dou by dou beta log trace e raised to minus beta h cap is v into m divided by 2 pi beta h cap square raised to 3 by 2. So, logarithm, while the derivative of logarithm is 1 by that function, 1 by v into m divided by 2 pi beta h cap square raised to 3 by 2 into the derivative of this quantity, v into 3 by 2 m divided by 2 pi beta h squared square raised to half. Derivative is with respect to beta. So, you have to take derivative of this quantity. M divided by 2 pi h squared square is constant. 1 by beta derivative is minus 1 by beta square. Cancel all the terms. You will get it as 3 by 2 kt. Okay. So, expectation value of Hamiltonian is internal energy of the particle. And it is 3 by 2 kt for a particle in a cubical